Czar himself left affairs more and more to the Tsarina, a German-born but English-educated niece of Queen Victoria. The Tsarina's close friendship with her spiritual advisor, the lecherous and drunken monk Rasputin, led to a widespread campaign against the entire Tsarist regime. In the public mind, this relationship assumed vast dimensions. It became the symbol of all Russia's ills. The murder of Rasputin was hailed as an act of the highest patriotism. The winter of 1916-17 was particularly severe. Fuel was short, food queues lengthened. Pressures on the Tsar to change incompetent ministers continued from all sides. His own cousin wrote to him,
"The question is, shall Russia be a great state, free and capable of developing strong, or shall she submit to the iron German fist? Certain forces are leading you, and consequently Russia, to inevitable ruin. It is absolutely indispensable that the ministers and the legislative chambers should work together. The existing situation, with the whole responsibility resting on you and you alone, is unthinkable."
The British ambassador, Sir George Buchanan, doing what he could to keep Russia in the war, told the Tsar he must regain the confidence of his people. The Tsar replied, "Do you mean that I am to regain the confidence of my people, or that they are to regain my confidence?" Suddenly, in the early days of March 1917, frustration in the Petrograd food queues spilled over into revolt. People came out to protest, found many others there, and took courage. For the first time, there was doubt about the troops. The Tsar, true to character, washed his hands of the embarrassing situation and went to the front, leaving matters to the palace guard and the Petrograd garrison. Now, turbulent forces suddenly broke the surface of Russian life. The French ambassador watched from the safety of his room.
"I heard a strange and prolonged din which seemed to come from the Alexander Bridge. Almost immediately, a disorderly mob carrying red flags appeared at the end, which is on the right bank of the Neva, and a regiment came towards it from the opposite end. It looked as though there would be a violent collision, but on the contrary, the two bodies coalesced. The army was fraternizing with the revolt."
The vast Petrograd garrison of some 200,000 men was not typical of the army as a whole. It consisted of raw recruits, war-weary reserves, convalescents, and even punishment battalions. Many deserters from the front had drifted to the capital's streets. Before long, the whole garrison had joined the mob. In a desperate move to get the Tsar to introduce the necessary reforms, the president of the Duma, Rodzianko, sent him a telegram. The Tsar received it at his headquarters.
"This fat Rodzianko has sent me some nonsense to which I will not even reply."
Nothing could stop the sudden upsurge against the monarchy, symbol of the country's sufferings. Within days, the Tsar was forced to abdicate, and a 300-year-old dynasty came crashing to the ground. General amnesty was declared, and political prisoners were set free among the jubilant crowds. The Tsar's unpopular ministers were arrested.
It is difficult to say how many lives were lost in the bloodless revolution, but according to most accounts, they were under 1,000. In Petrograd, thanks to the measures taken by the government, the town rapidly resumed its normal aspect and order generally prevailed. This was especially noticeable on the occasion of the burial of the victims of the revolution in the Champ de Mars on April the 5th, when a never-ending procession filed past in the most perfect order from 10 in the morning till late in the evening. There were in all but some 200 coffins. And as each one was lowered into the grave, a salute was fired from the fortress. But no priests officiated at the ceremony, which was divested of any religious character.
Somewhat dazed with the success of the revolution, Russia had to face the bleak task of deciding where she would go. The rising in the streets had been against something. Now the people had to decide exactly what it had been for. The wish to run the war more efficiently had given the revolution its spark, but hatred of the war had given it much of its momentum. In the confused situation that followed, responsibility fell upon the Duma, responsibility to make good their implied promises. Now they had to do better than the autocracy they had for so long criticized. A provisional government was formed with a liberal, Prince Lvov, as the first prime minister. A young socialist lawyer, Kerensky, became minister of justice. In the allied capitals, where the events in Russia looked simpler than they were, the revolution was hailed as a triumph for the allied cause. The London Times commented,
"The army and people have joined hands to overthrow the forces of reaction which were stifling the national aspiration and strangling the national efforts."
Lloyd George declared in the House of Commons,
"We believe that the revolution is the greatest service the Russian people have yet made to the cause for which the Allied peoples have been fighting."
In America, herself about to enter the war on the Allied side, the revolution seemed providential. The Secretary of State declared,
"The revolution in Russia has removed the one objection to affirming that the European war was a war between democracy and absolutism."
In Petrograd, one of the provisional government's first acts was to declare that it would loyally maintain its alliances and do everything in its power to carry the war to a victorious conclusion. The French ambassador reported,
"Patriotism, intelligence, and honesty could be read on every face. But the task they have undertaken is patently beyond their powers. Heaven grant that they do not collapse under it too soon."
The new government's task was complicated by the fact that a quite separate revolutionary body convened itself in the same building, the Soviet. The Soviet, or Council, claimed to represent factory workers and soldiers. Its majority wanted to continue the war to defend the revolution. But one of the Soviet's first acts had been to issue Order Number 1 to the army, directed against the powers and status of officers and setting up soldiers' councils. In this uneasy alliance, the provisional government had to accept the Soviet's order. A struggle for the soul of Russia now began. A French observer noted,
"Groups were constantly forming without actual reason in the capital streets. One man would enter a discussion with another, and passers-by would listen in. The crowd thus witnessed open exchanges of political opinions in the course of which opposing ideas were pitted against one another. Groups were constantly forming and dispersing. At first sight, the crowd appeared to be full of unrest. Actually, it was only idle."
The Germans had always regarded a revolution as their best